وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، سورة البروج. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله على كل شيء شهيد إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا فلهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا فلهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير إن بطش ربك لشديد إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد وهو الغفور الودود وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال لما يريد هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود بل الذين كفروا في تكذيب والله من ورائهم محيط بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ. سورة البروج, which is a surah makkiyah. Surah Al-Buruj, the scholars of Tafsir, they've mentioned it talks and it deals with a story. Inshallah ta'ala, today bi-idhnillah al-kareem, we're going to take that story where Allah specifically mentions قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُخْدُودِ. Because by knowing the story, we will be able to understand the verses and what it means. And it will give us a good understanding of it. So inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to mention the story from Al-Imam Muslim Sahih. And then inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to extract some benefits from it, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. But before I mention the story, I wanted to say, brothers and sisters, it is a Quranic method to use stories to bring about benefits and reminder. It's the way that the Quran follows, and the Quran does that a lot. Allah says in the Quran, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَرَفَعْنَاهُ بِهَا وَلَكِنَّهُ أَخْلَدَ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ إِنْ تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكْهُ يَلْهَثْ ذَلِكَ مَثَلُ الْقَوْمِ الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ فَاقْصُصِ الْقَصَصَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. So Allah tells us here, فَاقْصُصِ الْقَصَصَ, tell them the story and inform them about the stories. So the Quran takes that method in which it brings stories and it tells the Prophet ﷺ and the companions and the believers stories. That's what Allah said in the beginning of Surah Yusuf. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ بِمَا أُحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ. That, O Muhammad, we are going to tell you the best of stories. So the Quran, it brings about stories. And the story of the Quran is what helped the Messenger salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi through the course of his da'wah. Because it's the stories of those prophets in which he is being told, you are going to go through what they went through. And the calamities and the hardship that they endured is exactly what you're going to endure. So come with the patience which they came with, and the patience that they showed. وَلِذَلِكَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى, He says in the Quran, and this is the ending of Surah Hud. After Surah Hud, Allah mentions how many stories? Many prophets. Allah tells the Prophet ﷺ many prophets and what they went through and how they called their nations. At the ending of Surah Hud, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, وَكُلًّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. Allah tells the Prophet ﷺ, all of these prophets, we've told you their stories, and their story in which we brought to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, we did this, مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. The aim and objective in telling you these stories is to actually solidify in your heart and make certainty come to you. And it's true. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the stories that were told to him actually solidified his heart. And he took from it yaqeen and certainty. You all know the hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated in the qismatu of the Battle of Hunayn. That Battle of Hunayn, what did the Prophet do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to what? He started to give out the spoils of war. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the spoils of war, he chose to give some people more than others. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for example, Aqra ibn Habis, he gave him 100 camels. And the Prophet did it because of a hikmah and a wisdom behind it. So when he gave each person, he thought that was, as it's called, mu'allafat al-qulub, a people's hearts, he wanted to bring close. He was choosing to give them more than other people. And this is something that the Prophet was using from the wahi and revelation. So when the Prophet did that, a group of people, or specifically an ill individual, what he did was, he said, هَذِهِ قِسْمَةً مَا أُرِيدَ بِهَا وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. He said about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's giving, that this was a giving that was Allah's face was not intended. The way that the Prophet gave, and he gave out the camels and the spoils of war, it was not done for the sake of Allah. So when the companion, he went and he told the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and when he told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, the Prophet said, if I am not just, and if I, Nabiullah Muhammad, is not, if I'm not fair, then who's fair? Allah's revelation comes down to me. Allah entrusted me with a revelation. But after that, what did the Prophet then say alayhi salatu wasalam? He said, رحم الله أخي موسى. May Allah bestow mercy on my brother Musa. قد أوذي أكثر من ذلك فصبر. He was put through more calamities and more hardship than this, and he endured patience. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the story of Nabiullah Musa helped him, did it not? It helped him to be patient. That's why Allah وَكُلًّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. So it made the Prophet's heart become firm and steadfast. Musa was tested. Allah tells us in the Quran, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ لِمَ تُؤْذُونَنِي وَقَدْ تَعْلَمُونَ أَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا وَقَدْ تَعْلَمُونَ أَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Nabiullah Musa, he said to his people, لِمَ تُؤْذُونَنِي, why are you harming me? And you are fully aware of أَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, that I am a prophet sent from Allah and a messenger sent from Allah. Allah also says in another place, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ وَقَفَّيْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِ بِالرُّسُلِ وَآتَيْنَا عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَقَدْ وَآتَيْنَا عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَيَّدْنَاهُ بِرُوحِ الْقُدُسِ أَفَكُلَّمَا جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ بِمَا لَا تَهْوَى أَنفُسُكُمْ اسْتَكْبَرْتُمْ فَفَرِيقًا كَذَّبْتُمْ وَفَرِيقًا تَقْتُلُونَ. Nabiullah Musa came, and then right after him came Nabiullah Isa ibn Maryam. Allah supported both prophets. Look what Allah then says. أَفَكُلَّمَا جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ. Every time a prophet comes to you, and every time a prophet is brought to you, you divide the prophets into two. فَرِيقًا كَذَّبْتُمْ. Some of the prophets you choose to disbelieve in them. وَفَرِيقًا تَقْتُلُونَ. And another group of prophets, you actually physically kill them. Nabiullah Zakariya was killed, and other prophets were killed. So, Nabiullah Muhammad, the stories in the Quran that was mentioned, it solidified his heart. And it made him be strong in his da'wah. So brothers, the Quran, it takes that method. But there's a problem that nowadays you see. You see a group of people who've made their whole da'wah based on story. They'll just tell stories. That's all they do. They tell stories. And they think by doing that they are in line with the Quran. And that is incorrect. The stories that you tell the people are stories that are authentic. Stories that you've taken from the Quran and the Sunnah. You don't tell people stories of your life or your stories of things that you saw. And your da'wah is fully based on that. And the Salaf, the pious predecessors, and even scholars that came after, they wrote books in warning against things like that. One of the books that are written is a kitab written by Jalaluddin al-Suyuti rahimahullah. He called it Tahdhir al-Khawwas, warning the general mass and the people from what? Min akadib al, the lies and the making up of the Qussas, the storytellers. Maktabat al-Islami authored that book. So the Qur'an, the stories that are in it are stories that we take. Inshallah ta'ala, let's go over the story of this surah, Suratul Buruj, the story. The story is as follows. It's in Sahih Muslim and it's lengthy. So inshallah ta'ala, we're going to take it. The companion Suhaib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ, that the Prophet said, كَانَ مَلِكٌ فِي مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ. There was a king that came before you. وَكَانَ لَهُ سَاحِرٌ. This king, he had a magician. There was a king and he had a magician. فَلَمَّا كَبِرَ, when the king, when the magician got old and he aged, قَالَ لِلْمَلِكِ, he said to the king, إِنِّي قَدْ كَبِرْتُ, I have reached an old age. I'm a bit old now. فَابْعَثْ إِلَيَّ غُلَامًا أُعَلِّمُهُ السِّحْرَ. What I want from you is you bring to me a young boy who I can teach magic to. I want you to bring me a boy. I'm growing old now. I want to pass my knowledge over to a young boy. Bring him to me. أُعَلِّمُهُ السِّحْرَ, and I'm going to teach him magic. فَبَعَثَ إِلَيْهِ غُلَامًا. So the king found a boy for him and he brought the boy to the magician. يُعَلِّمُهُ, he started to teach him magic and sorcery. فَكَانَ فِي طَرِيقِي, this boy, from his house towards the magician, every day he would leave his house and he would go to the magician to take knowledge from him. On the way, there was a monk, a worshipper, a man who believed in Allah and he believed in the Day of Judgment, a man who was not of the belief of the people. So he had this monk. So he started, فَقَعَدَ إِلَيْهِ, he started to sit with him. وَسَمِعَ كَلَامُهُ, and he started to listen to his speech and what he was saying and what he was delivering. فَأَعْجَبَهُ, it amazed him what he was saying. The truth, when it comes to the person, the soul and the fitrah likes it. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He placed in us fitrat Allah allati fatara an-nas 'alayha. The people are in line with the fitrah and the truth, the haqq. As Mu'adh ibn Jabal said, inna 'ala al-haqqi nura. The haqq has a light, that the person, when he sees the truth, he automatically is in love with it. So the boy, he was amazed by what he heard. فَكَانَ إِذَا أَتَى السَّاحِرَ مَرَّ بِالرَّاهِبِ. So whenever he would go to the magician, he would stop over to the monk, and he would take knowledge from the monk. And when he would come back from the magician, and he would be going home, he would also stop at the monk, and he would take knowledge from him. So from when he leaves home to the magician, on the way he sits with the monk, he takes knowledge from the monk. And on the way back, he does the same. So what happened was, this had actually brought to the magician some form of realization, because the boy keeps coming late. He keeps coming late. فَعَاتَبَهُ. So he warned him of this, and he said, stop doing what you're doing. And so when the boy kept coming late, the magician physically beat him. He beat the boy, and he harmed him. And his parents, he would come home late, so they would also become upset for his delay, and why he would come home late. فَشَكَى ذَلِكَ إِلَى الرَّاهِبِ. So he went to the monk, and he said, oh monk, I'm in trouble with my mom and my parents, and I'm also in trouble with who? The magician. He's also upset with me. So when the monk heard the concern and the problem that the boy put forward, he said to him, فَقُلْ. Say, حَبَثَنِي أَهْلِي. When you go to the monk, the magician, say to the magician that the thing in which I came late was my parents. They are the ones who delayed me. And when you go to your parents, فَقُلْ حَبَثَنِي السَّاحِرُ. And when you go to your parents, say, I got delayed by the magician. So the boy kept saying that, and the problem stopped. The magician thought he was late at home, and the parents thought he got delayed by the magician. فَبَيْنَمَا هُوَ كَذَلِكَ. The boy was like that. And he kept going to the monk, seeking knowledge from him, learning from him. He would go to the magician as well. And you can see the boy has a challenge where he haqq and batil is presenting itself to him. One day the boy, he comes in contact on a path. He is walking somewhere. And he sees the people that they are not able to take a particular path. فَبَيْنَمَا هُوَ كَذَلِكَ إِذْ أَتَى عَلَى دَابَّةٍ. And he came to a place where the people were gathered. Some of the riwayat mention the road was closed by a lion. So he asked the people, what is the problem? And what's the issue? They said that this beast has locked off the road and the people are unable to tread on this path. So the boy said, is that the case? They said, yes. The boy said to himself, Al-Yawma, today, أَعْلَمُ السَّاحِرُ أَفْضَلُ أَمِرْ رَاهِبُ أَفْضَلُ. Today I'm going to know who's more virtuous, who's real about what they were saying. Was the magician right? Or was the monk right? I'm going to find out today. فَأَخَذَ حَجَرًا. He took a stone. And when he took the stone, he said, اللهم أو الله إن كان أمر الراهب أحب إليك. Oh Allah, if the affairs of the monk is most beloved to you, min amri sahiri, then the matter of the magician, faqtul hadhihi dabba, get rid of and destroy this beast. And he threw the stone at the beast. Hatta yamdi an-nas, so the people cross this road. When he hit it, faqatalaha, the beast died. Wa madha an-nas, when the people, they walked on the path. فأتى الراهب. The boy came to the monk. فأخبره. He told him. فقال له الراهب. The monk said to him, أي بنيم, my son. My son, anta al-yawma afdalu minni. Today you're better than I am. You're more virtuous than I am. You're more greater than I am. قَدْ بَلَغَ مِنْ أَمْرِكَ مَا أَرَى. Your matter has reached where it's reached today, as I see. وَإِنَّكَ سَتُبْتَلَى. And you will be tested greatly. You're going to go through great calamities and great hardship. فَإِنِبْتُلِيتَ. If you are tested as I tell you, and you are put through this trial and tribulation, فَلَا تَدُلَّ عَلَيَّ. Don't tell anyone about me. Don't say the monk, there's a monk, somebody taught me this. Don't talk about me. You will be tested, but don't tell anyone about me. وَكَانَ الْغُلَامُ. This boy, يُبْرِهُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ. The people who have leprosy and the people who are blind, both of them, he would cure them with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he also cured people from other illnesses that they had. So the king had a man who used to sit with him, Hashiyatul Malik, Jalisul Malik, a man who was the right-hand man of the king, who was blind. Many years the magician was working on it, but wouldn't be able to bring back, he wouldn't be able to bring back the eyesight of the boy. So when he heard that the young boy brings back people's eyesight with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Hashiyatul Malik, Jalisul Malik, the right-hand man of the king, he took so much gifts with him. Faqala, he said to the boy, he came to him and he placed all of the gifts in front of him. Faqala, he said, Ma ha hunak lak. This which you see in front of you is all for you. In anta shafaytani, if you cure me from what I am in, my blindness, everything which I have placed in front of you, all of it is yours. Faqala, the boy looked at the right-hand man of the king and he said to him, Inni la ashfi ahadan. I don't cure anybody. Cure is not in my hand. Innama yashfi Allah. The one who cures, and the cure is in his hand, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنْ أَنْتَ آمَنْتَ بِاللَّهِ. If you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you become a believer, دَعَوْتُ اللَّهِ. I will ask Allah, فَشَفَاكَ. And Allah will cure you. فَآمَنَ بِاللَّهِ. The blind man, he believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَشَافَاهُ. فَشَفَاهُ اللَّهِ. Allah then cured him from the blindness. He gained his eyesight. فَأَتَى الْمَلِكِ. So the man, he came and he walked on to the king. And he came to him the next day. كَمَا كَانَ يَجْلِسُ. As he would come every day. He's the right-hand man of the king. So he came into the onto the king. فَقَالَ لَهُ الْمَلِكُ. The king said to him, مَنْ رَدَّ عَلَيْكَ بَصَرَكَ. Who brought your eyesight back? قَالَ رَبِّي. My lord. قَالَ. He said to him, وَلَكَ رَبٌّ غَيْرِي. Do you have a lord other than me? Is there a lord that exists other than me? He said, قَالَ رَبِّي وَرَبُّكَ اللَّهِ. My lord and your lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأَخَذَهُ. The king grabbed the man, فَلَمْ يَزَلْ يُعَذِّبْهُ. He punished him severely, حَتَّى دَلَّ عَلَى الْغُلَامِ. He beat him. And then he got out of the boy. It got out of the right hand man of the king. He got out of him, the person who brought him this message. Where this came from. The person who brought him to Islam. So he said, oh, the boy. So they brought the boy. When they brought the boy, and the boy walked in, the king said to him, Ay bunayya, my son. قَدْ بَلَغَ مِنْ سِحْرِكَ مَا تُبْرِئُ الْأَكْمَهَ وَالْأَبْرَصَ وَتَفْعَلُ وَتَفْعَلُ. He didn't take the approach that he took with the blind man. The approach that he took with him was to deceive him in speech. He said, my son, you have reached in your sorcery and your magic that you can actually now cure people who have leprosy and people who are blind and people who have these type of illnesses. And if the boy goes, yes, I do, with the magic. Kafara billah, he's a disbeliever, right? So the boy, he says to him, إِنِّي لَا أَشْفِي أَحَدًا, I don't cure anyone. إِنَّمَا يَشْفِي اللَّهِ, the one that cures, the one who has leprosy, and the one who is blind, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأَخَذَهُ فَلَمْ يَزَلْ يُعَذِّبُ, then he took the boy and he punished him and put him through torment. حَتَّى دَلَّ عَلَى الرَّاهِبِ, until the boy, he said, I got this from the monk. فَجِئَ بِالرَّاهِبِ, they brought in the monk, they walked him in. And when they walked him in, فَقِيلَ لَهُ إِرْجِعْ عَنْ دِينِكَ, the monk, nothing else was told to him. He was only given one option, which is, turn back what you're upon. And this is powerful, because the reason why the rahib needs to come back is that if he leaves the belief, everybody else will leave. It will shake everybody else. He's the one who told everybody this. When people take the person as a role model, if he does a mistake, it makes everybody else shake. So they said to the rahib, no other option for you. You just need to leave the religion. فأبا, he refused. فَدَعَى بِالْمِنْشَارِيدِ, so they called for a blade. فَوَضَعَ الْمِنْشَارُ فِي مَفْرَقِ رَأْسِهِ, they placed it right on the top of his head and he got sliced into two. The rahib died. Then they went to the ghulam. They said to him, إِرْجِعْ عَنْ دِينِكَ, turn away from your religion. The boy, he refused. So he passed him over to a group of men. He said, take him. The boy, he doesn't want him to be killed straight away like that. He said, take him. Take him to a mountain and place him on top of a mountain. Throw him off that mountain. But before you throw him off, if he cries and he becomes emotional and he comes back to his senses and he leaves what he's upon, then bring him back. And if not, then throw him off. So they took him, and when they reached the top of the mountain, the boy said, Allahumma, oh Allah, ikfinihim bimashita, oh Allah, suffice me from them, however you will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. However you want, oh Allah, do it. فَرَجَفَ بِهِمُ الْجَبَلِ, the mountain started to shake. And it threw them off. فَسَقَطُوا, they all of them poured off the mountain. And this is the amazing part of the story. وَجَاءَ يَمْشِي إِلَى الْمَلِكِ, the boy cleared the dust, the dirt off himself. He got up. He didn't go home, because he's got a message to convey. The boy walks into the king again. He goes exactly to the king. He doesn't go home. He doesn't go to sleep. He doesn't go hiding. He walks on into the king's palace and he stands in front of him. The king then says to him, مَا فَعَلَ أَصْحَابُكَ, where are the people I sent with you? Look what the boy said again. كَفَانِيهِمُ اللَّهِ, the one that sufficed me from them is Allah. Every time this boy is attributing everything to who? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَدَفَعَهُ إِلَى نَفَرٍ مِّنْ أَصْحَابِهِ, then he told another group of men, go grab him. They grabbed him. فَذَهَبُوا بِهِ, they took him. فَحَمَلُوهُ فِي قُرْقُورٍ, they placed him in a small boat. They put him in a small boat. And then he said to them, فَتَوَسَّطُوا بِهِ الْبَحْرَ, when you're in the middle of the ocean or the sea, throw him in. If he repents and he comes back to his senses and he comes back to the correct way, then bring him back safely. If not, وَإِلَّا, and if that, he doesn't do it, فَقْذِفُوهُ, throw him into the ocean and the sea. فَذَهَبُوا بِهِ, they took the boy, and then he, in the middle of the ocean, he looked up to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and he said, اللهم اكفنيهم بما شئت, oh Allah, suffice me from these people however you wish, however you want it, oh Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he destroyed them in the ocean and he brought him out saliman, safe. Nothing happened to him. He came walking again to the king. When he came to the king said to him, مَا فَعَلَهُ أَصْحَابُكَ, where are the people I sent with you? Where are the people I sent with you? Then he said, كَفَانِيهِمُ اللَّهِ. Allah sufficed me from them. Allah got rid of them. Then he said to the king, فَقَالَ لِلْمَلِكِ إِنَّكَ لَسْتَ بِقَاتِلِيَّ. You are not going to be able to kill me. King, you will not be able to kill me. You won't be able to. حَتَّى تَفْعَلَ مَا أَمُرُكَ بِهِ. Until you do what I command you to do. This is the king who believes in Allah. He's now being told by the boy what to do. Listen to me, I'm going to tell you what you should do and how you do it. The king is now da'if, weak. And then he says, قَالَ وَمَا هُوَ. What is it that you want me to do? How do you want me to do it? What do you want me to do? It's the king that was never told what to do. He tells everybody what to do. He's now listening to the boy. The boy is telling him how things should be done. He said, تَجْمَعُ النَّاسِ. You bring all the people for me. فِي صَعِيدٍ وَاحِدٍ. In one place. I want you to gather all of the people in one place. Everybody has to be there. That day, I want everybody there. Okay. وَتَصْلُوبُنِي عَلَى جِذْعٍ. And you hang me from a branch. You're gonna place me on the branch and you're gonna hang me from it. Okay? ثُمَّ خُذْ سَحْمًا. Take my arrow. Not the arrow that you have or anything else. No, you take my arrow. Okay. مِنْ كِنَانَتِي. From my push of arrows where it's in, you're gonna take that and you're gonna use the arrow. ثُمَّ ضَعِ السَّحْمَ فِي كَيْدِ الْقَوْسِ. Place the arrow you took and place it inside the qaws. Qaws is the bow, right? Place it inside the bow and direct it at me. When you direct it at me, you utter this word. You say this. This is what I want you to say. And what do you want me to say? He said, قُلْ. Say, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ رَبِّ الْغُلَامِ. When you're throwing the arrow at me and you're directing it to kill me, say the following. Say, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ. Say, بِسْمِ اللَّهِ. In the name of Allah. رَبِّ الْغُلَامِ. You say, when you take the arrow, you say, Bismillahi, in the name of Allah, Rabbi al-Ghulami, the Lord of the boy. ثُمَّ رْمِنِي. Then throw that at me. فَإِنَّكَ إِن فَعَلْتَ ذَلِكَ. If you do that, فَتَقْتُلُنِي. You're going to kill me. فَجَمَعَ النَّاسِ. The king said, okay, I promise, I'll do that. King brought everybody. He brought all of the people together. This boy, his life, his existence, his everything is nothing. He has a mission in life. فَجَمَعَ النَّاسِ. The people came together. The king did everything. فِي صَعِيدٍ وَاحِدٍ. In one place. وَصَلَبَهُ عَلَى جِذْعٍ. He hanged him from a branch. ثُمَّ أَخَذَ السَّحْمًا. He took the arrow from him as he promised. ثُمَّ وَضَعَ السَّحْمَ فِي كَبَدِ الْقَوْسِ. He placed it on the bow. And he directed it at the boy. And he said, Bismillahi Rabbil Ghulam. He said it. When he said it, he directed it at the boy. ثُمَّ رَمَاهُ فَوْقَ السَّهْمِ فِي صُدْغِهِ فَوَضَعَ يَدَهُ فِي صُدْغِهِ فِي مَوْضِعِ السَّهْمِ فَمَاتَ. He directed the arrow at the boy. He hit it, the boy on the head. And the boy died. فَقَالَ النَّاسُ. The people then said, آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ الْغُلَامِ. We believe in the Lord of this boy. When they heard what the king did, they saw him doing what he was doing, the whole of the people who were there, they all said, آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ الْغُلَامِ. We believe in the Lord of the boy. آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ الْغُلَامِ. آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ الْغُلَامِ. And the people started to say as they went louder. فَأُوْتِيَ الْمَلِكِ. They came to the king and they told him. فَقِيلَ لَهُ أَرَأَيْتَ مَا كُنْتَ تَحْذُرُ قَدْ وَاللَّهِ نَزَلْ. That which you were warning against has now taken place. The boy has left behind something. He's gone. But what he did was, the message went over to the rest. The king then said, okay, every single road of the city, place a ditch. Burn that ditch, every road. Place a ditch there and make a fire there. every single person, ask him, are you going to be upon that religion of the boy, or are you going to take me as your Lord? If they say, we're going to take you as the king, as the Lord, then let them free. If not, throw them into the fire. The people were being asked, and they were saying, the Lord of the boy, the Lord of the boy, آمنا برب الغلام, آمنا برب الغلام, and they were being thrown into the fire. Until one woman came, who was breastfeeding a child of hers. So she held back. Not because of herself, but because of her child. She withheld. فَقَالَ لَهَا الْغُلَامُ, the boy said to her, يَا أُمِّي, my mother, اصْبِرِي فَإِنَّكَ عَلَى الْحَقِّ, my mother, be patient, for verily you are upon the truth. It was a child that she was breastfeeding. The child looked at his mother when she فَتَقَعَصَتْ, when she withheld, and she thought, I don't want to go into the fire. And she thought she might pull back. The little child said to her, Ya Ummi, my mother, اصْبِرِي, be patient, فَإِنَّكِ عَلَى الْحَقِّ, you are truly upon the truth. This story is in one of the most authentic books. This is Sahih Muslim. Story is Sahih, Thabit. The Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam. There are fawaid and benefits that we can take from it. I extracted 30 benefits, inshallah. 30. And some of you guys, if you look at it more, you might be able to extract more. But inshallah ta'ala, today I'm going to mention 14 of them. And we will leave the other part, the other fawaid and the ahkam and the rulings that we can take from it, inshallah ta'ala, in our next tafsir lesson bi-idhnillah al-kareem. The first lesson, the first benefit that we take from it is that anna likulli fir'aun, that every tyrant leader, every oppressive leader, he has sahara, he has magicians. Every tyrant leader, they all have magicians. And magicians that work right under them, that use magic to spread whatever they want to do. Any leader who does not rule by what Allah has sent down and does not take it as the constitution, and that is what they judge by. Magicians are what? Is where they refer back to and what they go to. This is a sunnah of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, لا تتغير ولا تتبدل. It's a sunnah of Allah that does not change, nor does it alter. The second benefit that we take from this story is وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ وَارِثٍ. Every single nation and every single people, they have somebody who inherits something from them. Whether it be a good people, their good is inherited from them. Or whether it be an evil people, their evil is inherited. Look at the magician. What did he say? He said, إِنِّي قَدْ كَبِرْتُ, I have reached an old age. فَابْعَثْ إِلَيَّ غُلَامًا وَعَلِّمُهُ السِّحْرِ. What did he say? I am a what? The magician, what did he say? I have reached a what? I have reached an old age. So what does he want? What does he want? He wants somebody who he can teach his magic to. فَابْعَثْ إِلَيَّ غُلَامًا وَعَلِّمُهُ السِّحْرِ. I want a boy I can teach magic to. وَلِذَلِكَ the ulama, what did they say? وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ وَارِثٍ. Every nation and every people, there's some people who inherit you. Whether it be good, some people are going to take the good from it and inherit it from you. That's why the hadith of Abi Darda, what did the Prophet say? الْعُلَمَاء وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَإِنَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ لَمْ يُوَرِّثُوا دِرْهَمًا وَلَا دِينَارًا وَإِنَّمَا وَرَّثُوا الْعِلْمِ فَمَنْ أَخَذَهُ أَخَذَ بِحَذٍ وَافِرٍ. That the prophets, what did they inherit? Sorry, the scholars, what did they inherit? They inherited from who? The prophets. So what is it that is inherited from the prophets? So Ahlul Batil, Ya Ikhwa, they're always trying to work hard to leave behind their falsehood and their corrupted ideologies so that other people can inherit it from them. Ahlul Kufr, the kuffar and the disbelievers and the ahlul bid'ah, that's their sunnah. They always want to leave behind their corrupted ideologies and their corrupted beliefs so some people can inherit it from them. The third benefit is أهمية التعلم في الصغر, the importance of learning and becoming a person of knowledge or attaining knowledge when you're young. Who did the magician want to teach his magic to? He said, فَابْعَثْ إِلَيَّ غُلَامًا أُعَلِّمُهُ السِّحْرَ. I want you to send me a boy, a young boy, I can teach magic to. He didn't say elderly person. This magician is what? He is very smart. He's clever. He's a very experienced man. That shows you he's very experienced, because he knows that knowledge to a person who is young is greater than teaching somebody who is what? Who is old. Al-Imam Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, he said, Al-ilmu fi al-sigari kan naqshi ala al-hajari. Al-Imam Hassan al-Basri said, knowledge when you are young is like carving into rock. When somebody's young and they learn and they attain knowledge, it's like carving into rock. They don't forget easily. Little kids, they memorize something, subhanAllah, it just stays there, it just doesn't go. Some of the Salaf, they even went as far as saying as that knowledge that they attained when they were young was the best type of knowledge that they attained. Look at what Al-Qamah said. Al-Qamah said, مَا حَفِظْتُ وَأَنَا شَابٌ فَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَيْهِ فِي قِرْطَاسٍ أَوْ وَرَقَةٍ. Al-Qamah said, مَا حَفِظْتُ, I never memorized. وَأَنَا شَابٌ, whilst I was a young person. Whilst I was a shab, a youth, I never memorized. Except what? فَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَيْهِ فِي قِرْطَاسٍ. It's as though I'm looking at it right in front of me. As though the scrolls and the papers are placed right in front of me. Whatever I memorized when I was young is like I'm still looking at it from a paper, I'm reading it. That's the memory that's in my head. مَا حَفِظْتُ وَأَنَا شَابٌ فَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَيْهِ فِي قِرْطَاسٍ أَوْ وَرَقَةٍ. So that's why the magician wanted to teach. He wanted to teach the boy. He wanted to teach the boy. Brothers, wallahi, you guys are young. Allah has given you guys the opportunity now. One of the greatest weapons, Ibn al-Qayyim said, أَكْبَرُ سِلَاحِ Iblis. The greatest weapon that Iblis has is a taswif. Taswif means what? To make somebody procrastinate. It's the biggest weapon of Iblis, procrastination. Will say to you, no, you don't need to do it now. Tomorrow. And tomorrow. But what you don't really understand and you realize, brothers, is that you are the most strongest and you are more better off today. Huh? Because you're young. 5 years, 10 years from now, you're old. So if you delay now and you leave it for another time, you're going to regret it. So it's better that you take knowledge now and you learn it. The fourth benefit that we take from the fa'idah that we take from the qissa to Ashab al-Khudud and the sahir and the rahib is talab al-haq, looking for the truth and trying to attain the truth. This young boy, he was running after the truth. Look how he was seeking knowledge. He was going to the monk. He was the one who was really eager to learn. And ya ikhwa, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees from you that desire, that want, and that passion for knowledge, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will give it to you. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, ذَلَّلْتُ طَالِبًا فَعَزَزْتُ مَطْلُوبًا. When I was trying to seek knowledge, I became humiliated. Remember Abdullah ibn Abbas, remember that time he heard a hadith from Abdullah ibn Ulays al-Ansari. Abdullah ibn Abbas got himself ready, prepared himself. He went to Abdullah ibn Ulays al-Ansari for one hadith to verify it. Just to verify it. Are we together, brothers? And when he came, he slept in front of his door. He wrapped around his face the imamah, and he lied in front of a companion, and the dust was gathering. This is the cousin of the Prophet. This is the Prophet's cousin. He's sleeping in front of a person's house. And then when the companion came out, he saw the Prophet's cousin right in front of his door. So he was what? He was shocked and he was baffled. And he said to him, why don't you tell somebody and I would come to you. Why don't you send somebody to me? I would come to you. Ibn Abbas sent an example, which is, Al-ilmu yu'ta wa la ya'ti. Knowledge is sought. It doesn't come to you. ولذلك, if you're sincere about something and you're passionate about it and you really want to attain that haqq, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will give you the tawfiq and the sadat. The fifth fa'idah that we take from the story of Ashab al-Ukhdud is مَنْ يَهْدِهِ اللَّهُ فَلَا مُضِلَّ لَهُ. Anybody who Allah wants to guide, there's no one to misguide him. If Allah wants guidance for you, and Allah wants to place the truth in your heart, and Allah wants to give you the truth, anybody who wants to misguide you can't misguide you. The guidance is in Allah's hand, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He can guide you. Look at the boy. He was between a magician and he's between a what? A magician and a monk. And look how Allah guided him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. إذن الهداية بيد من؟ بيد الله تبارك وتعالى. Al-A'sha was a poet, the Arab poet. A'sha was what? One of the greatest Arab poets. He had the ability that if he spoke, the Arabs would listen to him. So Quraysh heard that A'sha was preparing himself to leave Mecca to go to what? To go to Medina to take Islam. So they came after him. They took horses, they came after him. They said, "Where are you going, A'sha?" He goes, "I'm going to Medina, I'm going to take Islam, and I want to become a believer of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." They said, "A'sha, do you not know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prohibits zina? Do you not know that?" A'sha said, "I'm an old man, I don't want zina." They thought again. "Do you not know that he prevents and he prohibits the drinking of khamar?" A'sha said, "He does?" He said, "Yes. He prohibits khamar. And he says khamar is not allowed and no one should drink khamar." He said, "Okay, if that's the case, I will spend this whole year drinking khamar. Finish, I'll get rid of the desire in me for the khamar. I will get rid of it. The whole year I'm going to drink. And then after this year, I'm going to stop khamar and I'm going to Muhammad." And he died in that year. He died in what? In that particular year. Abu Talib, who is the Prophet's what? Uncle. Abu Talib was the Prophet's uncle. The Prophet took every means that a person can take to guide him. He said, "Qul la ilaha illallah, kalimat, a word, uhajju laka bihi yawm al-qiyamah. I'm going to speak on your behalf the day of judgment for you, the other part. And inshallah speak and aid, ask Allah for you." To who? Abu Talib. Even Abu Talib himself admitted that what the Prophet is upon is the truth. What did he say? He says, وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ بِأَنَّ دِينَ مُحَمَّدٍ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ دِينَ لَوْلَا الْمَلَامَةُ أَوْ حِذَارَ مُصَبَّتٍ لَوَجَدْتَنِي بِذَاكَ سَمْحًا مُبِينًا. That what Muhammad is calling to alayhi salatu wasalam, and that which is propagated, he said, "I admit it's the truth, it's the haqq, it's what Allah is, subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion." What is he scared of? لَوْلَا الْمَلَامَةُ أَوْ حِذَارَ مُصَبَّتٍ. He's only scared of the blame of others and the people, what they're going to say. And of course that which he has to say about his forefathers. If he takes Islam, he has to admit that Abdul Muttalib and what they were upon is kufr and they're in the hellfire. He doesn't want to say that. Because forefathers meant a lot to them. The Prophet did everything. And Allah then said the ayah, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. صح؟ So Allah guides whoever He wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The sixth benefit that we take from it is جواز الشكاية من أذى الآخرين. The sixth fa'idah that we take from the qissa of Ashab al-Ukhdud is it's permissible to complain about the harms that people put you through. You are allowed to complain if people are putting you through hardship. You can, and it's permissible. Because look at the boy, what did he do? He complained to the what? The monk about what the sahib is doing to him. That he beating him whenever he comes late. And Allah says in the Quran, لا يحب الله الجهر بالسوء من القوم من القول إلا من ظلم. لا يحب الله الجهر بالسوء من القول إلا من ظلم. That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala does not like a person to speak idle speech or speeches that are wrong. إلا من ظلم, except the person who's been oppressed, he can speak out. If he's been oppressed and he's wronged, He has the rights to speak out and say, this is what's been done to me. So if somebody is putting you through hardship and pain, the story teaches us that you can complain about them, about others. You can. As long as it doesn't go against what? As long as you're not ittihamul qadr, you're not accusing the qadr. Number 7 is jawazul kadhib lil darura. That is permissible to lie when there's a necessity. When there's a necessity, a person is allowed to, he's allowed to lie. Al-Imam al-Nawawi extracted that from this story. Al-Imam al-Nawawi in Sharh al-Sahih Muslim, in this part of the story, when the boy said, فَقُلْ حَبْ فَقُلْ, the monk said to the boy, say to your parents, sorry, say to the magician, حَبَسَنِي أَهْلِي, my family imprisoned me. They are the ones who are delaying me. And say to the magician, sorry, say to your family that the magician, he's the one who's delaying you. And Imam al-Nawawi at this point, Sharh Sahih Muslim, he says that lying when there is a necessity is permissible. When there's a darura. When there is a darura. Number 8, the eighth benefit that we take from it is su'alullah, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance. And the benefit that he has when you ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala for guidance. The boy, what did he say? Allahumma in kana amru rahibi ahabba ilayka. Oh Allah, if the issue, remember when the beast was in front of him, what did he say? Oh Allah, if the issue of the monk is more beloved to you, then destroy this beast and let the people walk on this road. The question here is, was the boy before this a believer of Allah? Did he actually believe? Or was he still upon doubt? Ibn Allan, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, and Imam al-Nawawi and others, they all mentioned that the boy believed. And he was already a believer. The reason why they took from that he was a believer already is, why did he say, Allahumma in kana amru rahib? Oh Allah, if the monk's affair is more beloved to you, because he chose to say the monk and not the magician. And they started with the monk. If the monk is beloved to you, oh Allah, in kana amru rahibi ahabba ilayka. If the issue of the monk is more beloved, he didn't say the magician. But why would he want to see if he already believed? The scholars, they said, this is like Ibrahim, what he did. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ, when Ibrahim said, رَبِّي أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى قَالَ أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِنْ قَالَ بَلَى وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. Nabiullah Ibrahim, when he said, oh Allah, أَرِنِي, show me, كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى, how you give life to the dead. Allah says to him, قَالَ أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِنْ, Ibrahim, did you not believe? قَالَ بَلَى, oh Allah, of course I believe in it. وَلَكِنْ, I'm only asking you, لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي, so my heart can find what? Tranquility from this. And as you know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَيْسَ الْخَبَرُ كَالْمُعَيَنَةِ, that seeing something is not like hearing it. Hearing something is not like seeing it, sorry. Hearing something is not like when you actually see the thing. Because seeing it increases more for you. The 9th benefit that we take from this story is إِثْبَاتُ كَرَامَاتِ الْأَوْلِيَاء, that we establish that the awliya of Allah, they have what? They have karamat. The awliya of Allah, they have karamat. Karamat are what? That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he gives them, huh? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he gives them a karama. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, in his kitab al-Nubuwat, he mentions that the karama is something Allah gives to his awliya. Ahlul Sunnah believe in it. There are two groups that go against Ahlul Sunnah, both on two sides, and Ahlul Sunnah always in the middle, right? The group that doesn't believe in karamat, jumlatan wa tafseela, they don't believe in it in any way, form or shape, are the aqlaniyun, like the Mu'tazila. Mu'tazila don't believe in karamat. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah in his Nubuwat, the Mabahith, the first early stage parts of the book, he refutes them. Also what? The Sufiyah who go extreme in the karamat. They go what? A person la yusalli, wa la yarka, wa la yasjud, who is a shaytan marik, who doesn't believe in Allah, wa la yawm al-akhir. They say he's got what? He's a magician. They say he's what? It's karamatu? Karamatu al-awliya. Rather, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentioned that every single believer is a wali min awliya'illah. Every believer is. Lakin, the awliya of Allah are different levels. Because what's the ayah? Ala inna awliya Allahi la khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun. Alladhina amanu. Wa kanu yattaqun. Every believer has iman and taqwa, right? But then not everybody's iman and taqwa is the same. Levels. So the more the person's iman increases, the more they are a greater awliya of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Also, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentioned something very powerful, which is some people think that the awliya of Allah, the karamat that Allah gives them, it has to be khawariq al-ada. They have to be something out of the norms that they do. Sahih? Or else that person has not been given what? He has not been given karamat, or he's not from the awliya of Allah, they think. Sahih? In this ummah, who's the biggest wali of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala? Huh? After Nabi Muhammad, who is it? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. Did Abu Bakr ever do any khawariq al-ada? Anything out of the norms? Did it happen for him? Huh? No, he didn't. So it's not a condition for a person to have karamat from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and to be from the awliya of Allah, they has to have khawariq al-adat. It's not. And also some people, I remember Somalia, I remember they said this woman, they said that she's awliya of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and whatnot. Hey, what's her awliya? How is she awliya of Allah? They said she takes one step from Somalia and the other step she takes to Hajj. That's it. Two steps. Like she goes Hajj and she comes back. I said, wallahi, this is not karamat. This is not sifa min awliya illah. Why? Because what we learnt is that the thing that a person is a wali for Allah, it has to not be something that opposes the kitab and the sunnah. The kitab and the sunnah teaches a woman cannot travel by herself. Yeah? She takes two steps. She's not traveling by herself. مُقَالِفُ لِلشَّرَعَ. So things like that do not show that this person has karamat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or a man who's crazy, who's taken his clothes off, they say, wallah, he's a wali min awliya illah. And the man is majnoon. The pen is lifted from him. Also the people Allah made them awliya and has given them karamat, they don't bully the people with their karamat. Huh? Wallah, if you don't do something for me, wallah, I'll call the awliya of Allah, tomorrow you're gonna be dead. He doesn't do that. But لا يفتخر. He doesn't boast and brag about it. As you can see from the story of the boy. Everything he was attributed to who? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. The tenth benefit that we take from the story is at-tawadu al-rahib. Ikhwani, the humility and the humbleness of the monk. Was the monk not humble when he said to him, Anta al-yawma afdalu minni. Today you are what? Anta al-yawma afdalu minni. Today you are better than me, oh boy. Ya bunayya, my son. Anta al-yawma, today you are greater than me. And this is sad because you don't find a teacher who, if he saw his student pass him and become better than him, he has the humbleness in him to say, wallahi, you're better than me. There's a story scholars mention that a teacher was asked a question and he wasn't able to answer it. And his student put his hand up and he said, I know how to answer it. I know I have the answer. Abdullah ibn Hajj in his kitab, Maraqis Su'ud, what did he say? فَكُلُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَنَاحِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ يَقُولُ لَا أَدْرِي فَكُنْ مُتَّبِعًا. If you don't know something and you're asked a question, then what you should say is Allahu A'lam. A person should teach themselves the etiquettes of saying what? They don't know, what do they say? Allahu A'lam. This is a shield that the believer runs to, or else, usibat maqatiluh, the person is destroyed. So the teacher said, Allahu A'lam. The student said, I know. Then he answered the question. Then the teacher became angry with the student. Who do you think you are? I am the teacher. I said, Allahu A'lam, how could you know what I don't know? He said, Sheikh, don't be upset with me. And don't be upset and angry with me. Didn't Allah tabarak wa ta'ala say in the Quran? Didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say in the Quran? وَتَفَقَّدَ الطَّيْرَ فَقَالَ مَا لِيَ لَا أَرَى الْهُدْهُدَ أَمْ كَانَ مِنَ الْغَائِبِينَ. Nabilahi Sulaiman, when he looked around and he couldn't find Hudhud, and then he said, Why is it that I can't see Hudhud? Or is Hudhud from those who are absent? Then what did Nabilahi Sulaiman say? He said after that, أَمْ كَانَ مِنَ الْغَائِبِينَ لَأُعَذِّبَنَّهُ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا أَوْ لَأَذْبَحَنَّهُ أَوْ لَيَأْتِيَنِّي بِسُلْطَانٍ مُبِينٍ سُلْطَانٍ مُبِينٍ. I will punish the bird severely, I will destroy it, I will kill it. Or she's going to come with me. Hudud has to give me a good reason why she was away. Hudud came, فَمَكَثَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ فَقَالَ أَحَطُّ بِمَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِهِ. Hudhud came back. And when Hudhud came back, what did it say to Sulaiman? أَحَطُّ بِمَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِهِ. I have come to know something you, Sulaiman, did not come to know about. I have knowledge of something you, Sulaiman, don't have knowledge of. Sulaiman is a what? It's a prophet from Allah. Hudhud is a what? He said, teacher, don't get angry with me. Hudhud knew something that Sulaiman didn't know. So the teacher should know humility and humbleness. And also the student, ya ikhwa, should respect his teacher, the person who taught you when you didn't know anything, you didn't understand anything. The poet, he said, وَعَلِّمُهُ الرِّمَايَةَ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ. Every day I teach him archery. You know archery? فَلَمَّا اشْتَدَّ سَاعِدُهُ رَمَانِي. When you learn archery and you learn how to use the archery and the arrow and the bow, you direct it at the person who taught you it. وَكَمْ عَلَّمْتُ نَظْمَ الْقَوَافِي. How many years was I teaching you how to write poetry? فَلَمَّا قَالَ قَافِيَةً هَجَانِي. And when you constructed the first line of poetry, you were directing it at your teacher. And the poet also said, وَمَنْ جَعَلَ الْمَعْرُوفَ فِي غَيْرِ أَهْلِهِ يَكُنْ حَمْدُ ذَمَنْ عَلَيْهِ وَيَنْدَمِي. Anyone who places good in somebody who does not deserve it and is not the rightful person for it, wallahi will regret it. Because you're not going to get from it except what? A regret. In Lamiyatul Arab, Shanfara, what does he say? He said, وَإِنِّي كَفَانِي فَقْدَ مَنْ لَيْثَ جَازِيًا بِحُسْنَى وَلَا فِي قَلْبِهِ مُتَعَلَّلٌ ثَلَاثَةُ أَصْحَابٍ قَلْبٌ مُشَيَّعٌ وَأَبْيَضُ إِسْبِيتٍ وَصَفْرَاءُ عَيْطَلٌ. This is a long story after he found out that his mother wasn't his mother. But anyways, the point, a person who doesn't place the teacher in his place and doesn't understand his value is an issue. The same way that the teacher has to realize that if your student passed you, you have tawadu and humility, and you admit that Allah has blessed him and given him better than what he's given you. The 11th benefit that we take from it is jawazu madh al-shakhsi, the permissibility of praising a person in their face. Didn't the teacher praise the student and say, أنت اليوم أفضل مني, today you're better than I am. The hadith shows us that it is permissible that you can praise a person in their face with the condition that you're not scared that it may cause this person to be arrogant. If you know that it's going to cause them to become arrogant and full of themselves, then you shouldn't do it. The 12th benefit that we take from the hadith is, إِنَّ مِن سُنَنِ اللَّهِ الْكَوْنِيَّةِ وُقُوعِ الْبَلَاءِ. That from the sunnah of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is what? That every single person who stands up to call to the religion of Allah, he will be tested, and calamities and hardship he will be put through. Didn't he say to him, the monk, did he not say to the boy, إِنَّكَ سَتُبْتَلَى, you're going to be tested. سَتُبْتَلَى, you're going to be tested. Ibn Alan, rahimahullah ta'ala, has a kitab called Dalil al-Falihin, which is Turuq al-Riyad al-Salihin. It's a sharah on Kitab al-Riyad al-Salihin. He mentions the way that the monk knew that the boy was going to be tested is because this is the sunnah of Allah for the righteous people and the good and the scholars and the people of knowledge and the prophets. What did Waraqah ibn Nawfal say to Nabiullah Muhammad when he came out with the message? What was the thing he said to him? Waraqat ibn Nawfal. He said to him, Ya laytani fiha jad'an. If only that day which you're going through, what you're going to go through, I wish I was a young man. Waraqat ibn Nawfal is saying it. Laytani akunu. If only I would be hayyan idh yukhrijuka qawmuka, when your people are going to expel you from Mecca and you're going to have to run away to Medina. I wish that day I was alive. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to him, Awa mukhrijiyahum, are my people going to expel me from Mecca, my hometown? Am I going to be expelled from it? Then he said to him, Qala na'am. Yes. Lam ya'ti rajulun qattun bimithli ma ji'ta bihi. No person has ever come with that which you have come with. Illa udi, except that he faced great hostility. And then he went on to say, "Wa yudrikni yawmuka, if I can only reach that day, which you're going to go through that, ansuruka nasran mu'azzaran, I would aid you a great aiding." The 13th benefit that we take from it is adam al-iqtirar bil karabati wa nisbatuha ila Allah, that we do not become deceived by the things Allah blesses us with, brothers. If Allah gives you karama, something Allah blesses you with, like the boy here right now, he was a mustajab al-da'wah. Whenever he called on to Allah, Allah will accept his dua. If Allah gives you something and he blesses you with it, don't become deceived with it. If Allah gives you eloquency, if Allah gives you this, if Allah gives you that, whatever it may be, don't be deceived by it. And what do you do? Humble yourself in attributing this to who? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. Allah is the what? The king and the one who gives kingdom to everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. تُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءَ. Allah gives kingdom to whoever he wishes. وَتَزِّعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءَ. وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءَ. وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءَ. بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ. إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Allah is the one who does all of that. He's the king. So when you take a characteristic Allah gave you and you give it to yourself, you say, I came in this. إِنَّا وَرِثْنَا ذَلِكَ كَابِرًا عَنْ كَابِرٍ. We inherited this from our forefathers, you know. We've always had this. No, you didn't. Allah gave this to you. It's a blessing from Allah. Attribute it to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is sad because the music industry and the street life, everything is about, I got this. This is me. Which goes against this concept, which is al-iqtirar. The person becomes deceived. Look what Nabiullah Ibrahim said, وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ when I become sick, who kills me? Did he say, I kill myself? وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. Allah is the one who kills. Last but not least, the last benefit that we take from this for today, inshallah ta'ala, is istiqdamul wasail. Using every means, al-mutaha, taking every permissible means, taking it fi da'wati ila Allah ta'ala, calling to Allah. Look what this boy was curing people. And what was he also doing? He was with the permission of Allah, but he used that opportunity where he was curing the people. He used the opportunity to give da'wah. When the king, the Jalisul Malik, the man who was sitting with the king, came to him and placed all of the goods in front of him, what was it that he benefited? He's in need today. So what did he do? He said, "In amanta billahi, if you believe in Allah, I will ask Allah for you and Allah will cure you." Today you're a taxi driver, somebody's on your car. Give them a reminder. This is a fursa. You're a da'i in this position that you're in. When you're at work, when somebody comes to you, give da'wah through that means. These are wasail, means and opportunities Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has given you. You benefit from it. You call to Allah. You're in the airport. Somebody asks you about your clothes. What's this clothes that you're wearing? And then you go into tawheed and call this person to la ilaha illallah, what it means, and it's explain it to them. Look at Nabiullah Ibrahim, Nabiullah Yusuf. When they came to him and they told him about the dream, what did he say to them? He didn't tell them the interpretation of the dream straight away. What did he say? He said, Ya sahibi sijni arbabu mutafarriquna khayrun am illahu al-wahid al-qahhar. Ma ta'buduna min duni illa asma'un sammaytumuha antum wa aba'ukum ma anzala Allah biha min sultan. إن الحكم إلا لله أمر أن لا تعبدوا إلا إياه ذلك الدين القيم ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون. Then he said, يا صاحبي السجن أما أحدكما فيسقي ربه خمرا وأما الآخر فيصلب فتأكل الطير من رأسي قضي الأمر الذي فيه تستفتيان. He didn't tell them the dream straight away. What did he tell them? لا إله إلا الله. What it means. Rather, even before that, what did he say? Who did Yusuf attribute this interpretation of the dream? Who did he say taught him it? ذَلِكُمَا مِمَّا عَلَّمَنِي رَبِّي. Allah taught me this. إِنِّي تَرَكْتُ مِلَّةَ قَوْمٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَهُمْ بِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ كَافِرُونَ. I left the people who don't believe in Allah, nor the Day of Judgment. The disbelievers. That's مُقَدِّمَة. And then he told them about the interpretation of the dream. So if a person comes to you and they are in need and they want something from you, they want to borrow money from you, before you give them what they ask you for, give them da'wah. Benefit from the opportunity. And then after that, give them what they want. There are lessons that can be taken from this. And inshaAllah ta'ala, we're going to carry on the remaining fawaid that we can take from it next lesson. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, and shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.